alternative proteins. How will we eat in the future? From vegan meat alternatives to the use of technologies, such as precision fermentation and cell cultivation to produce food. That's what we're talking about.
Hello, zusammen.
Hello everyone, we're here in beautiful Switzerland near Lake Zurich. And what fermentation has to do with this Swiss chocolate? We'll show you in here. Food from cultivated cell cultures is being touted as a possible future alternative to food from conventional production. Why is that? Animal-based foods leave a large ecological footprint during their production. However, plant-based raw materials such as coca or coffee also consume a lot of resources before they are even used as raw materials in food production. The plants take several years to grow before the fruit is harvested. They only grow in certain tropical regions and are very sensitive to the effects of climate change. This is where Food Brewer comes in. A Swiss new food startup based in Horgen near Zurich, Food Brewer uses proven fermentation concepts from the brewing industry to produce plant-based foods and food ingredients sustainably.
Hello
everyone, today we're at the Food Brewer Company, a company that has set itself the goal of brewing chocolate or cocoa. With me is Thierry. What is Food Brewer's goal in brewing chocolate or cocoa?
We're here in Switzerland, and the Swiss eat a lot of chocolate. And our goal now is actually to produce chocolate more sustainably. For us, this means on the one hand that we need fewer pesticides or no pesticides at all. But we can also produce locally. We don't have to go to faraway countries to buy our raw materials, but we can really produce it here locally and in a quality that we can control on the one hand and where we're not dependent on various environmental factors that are becoming increasingly important for chocolate production due to the weather or climate change.
Immer wie größer werden auf die Schokoladenproduktion.
And how does it all work now? So how do you get the cocoa produced in a tank?
Der Weg startet eigentlich wie bei, ich sage jetzt mal, einer normalen Kakaofarm auch. Also wir starten mit der Bohne, mit dem.
The process actually starts in the same way as, let's say, a normal cocoa farm. So we start with the bean, with the seed of the cocoa fruit. And this cocoa bean, i.e. the seed, is also used in chocolate production. And we're now taking one of these seeds. We're looking at the cocoa fruit, the whole fruit. So the seeds are also inside. And we can take a so-called biopsy, i.e. we take some cells from this cocoa bean and can then transfer them to nutrient solutions in several steps. At the beginning, we're still in the Petri dish, which is a solid nutrient medium, where we can then grow the cells that we've previously taken from the biopsy of the bean in the solid nutrient medium. After a certain time, when the cells have become accustomed to the fact that they're no longer growing in the bean, but individually, they're then transferred to a liquid nutrient solution. And from this moment on, we're ready to cultivate even larger volumes, so that at some point we'll be able to cultivate the cells in the 50 liters that we see behind us here, or later in the 500 liters, and of course, ever larger, and produce our chocolate powder.
Und natürlich immer wie größer, dann die Zellen kultivieren können und so unser Schokoladenpulver eigentlich produzieren.
Das ist ja super spannend. Das bedeutet in.
That's really exciting. It means that the original cocoa bean cell is actually growing in the bottle here, or in the Petri dish, or later in the larger reactors.
Zelle der Kakaobohne an.
Genau, richtig. Also.
Exactly, that's right. So normally you would grow the whole cocoa tree. You would produce a lot of wood, you also have a few leaves. What we do, we really only produce the beans, or rather the cells of the beans. And you don't have to imagine that the beans come out at the end of the process, but that the finished cocoa powder actually comes out. Because the cells no longer grow in a compound, i.e. glued together, but they grow individually and are then mixed in the stirring vessel and thus supplied with nutrient medium.
And you just mentioned the culture medium. What do the cells need to grow? It probably won't be just water.
Exactly. In principle, it's mainly water, but it's not just water. So we also have nutrients in there. There aren't many different nutrients. It's mainly sugar, normal household sugar, like we have at home. And the cells metabolize this sugar and can grow as a result. In addition, they also need various salts or minerals, just as they are present in the soil or in the ground where the plants would normally grow.
Yes, and we'll now take a look at what the whole thing looks like on a larger scale. Now that we've looked at the fermentation process in the laboratory and seen how cocoa is produced biotechnologically, we're here now with Klaus Keeley in the pilot plant to take the next scaling step. Klaus, thank you very much for agreeing to answer our questions here today. The pilot plant, 500-liter scale, can you briefly talk about your goals, why you've now decided to go one size bigger and leave the laboratory?
We want, number one, the goal is really to produce on a food scale. In the food sector, as we all know, we need a completely different scale than in the pharmaceutical biotechnology. These are completely different volumes. It is therefore important for us to quickly move to a system that is scalable for a later process, which can then really be done at 50,000 liters or more. And that's why the 500 liters are the perfect pilot scale for us, as we have very good scalability from a steel system to a later production scale.
Our bioreactor approach, which we've now delivered to you here, is a little different from the state-of-the-art technology. We have a pipe-in-pipe system here, which circulates the tank contents.
We can also run a fed batch process. We can run our own semi-continuous process in it, and we are very shear sensitive if we compare that with an alligator that gets very high tip speeds. Plus, we really have the advantage. If we think of the very large tanks at 50,000 liters, 100,000 or more, that we don't have a vibrating large impeller, several impellers in it, so to speak, an energy saving. We are very interested in this, and it has now worked very well, even in the 500 liter.
We've also installed various sensors here in the plant. Which sensors are important for you? That is, which parameters do you need to measure during fermentation that we have now installed here?
Well, we did measure dissolved oxygen, temperature, pH, and conductivity. pH, dissolved oxygen, and temperature are the most important ones for us.
The whole system is now set up in such a way that we can scale it further. We have currently installed process control technology, or at least in very slimmed down form. But in principle, we can also extend it to different systems or other OEM equipment, if you wish, in order to then integrate the entire process control technology into the whole system to relieve you of some of the manual work in the whole system in the long term.
Exactly. We are still a bit manual here, as agreed with us, because we also want to try things out ourselves. We want to optimize. And when we have finalized the process now, then we can go to 50,000 liters and fully automated, low manpower, as little as possible, everything automated.
Yes, if we now look at our system in detail, we have the circulation loop here, in which we can circulate our liquid from the bioreactor. We have three different valve seats or connections on the tank, which can be connected on the suction side via the three valves on the right-hand side of the pump, or can also be connected on the pressure side of the pump. This allows us to achieve circulation in the tank either from top to bottom or bottom to top, depending on where we introduce or remove the liquid. In addition, this central connection also allows us to circulate only partial quantities in both directions, or to force sedimentation in the entire system. What we've not yet shown is the connection of the sparger line, that is, the aeration in the entire system. This is done from below into the tank. But as you said, we also have the flexibility here to blow air into the loop to see whether the distribution of air in the system improves and increases, because because your plants also have a relatively high oxygen requirement.
Yes, we hope. We actually hope. It's pretty much that we have a significantly better oxygen input from the loop because we have gassing in the loop. Here, for example, we can replace the sensor and build the gassing point directly here. This gives us a longer dwell time, a better oxygen transfer rate, and therefore we need much less air. We have far fewer problems with the exhaust air, the supply air, and it is much more scalable because less air is needed. We're looking forward to testing it out properly.
Thank you, Klaus, for the brief introduction to our system. I was pleased that we were able to be here. I was pleased that we're working together, and so much about the Steinecker bioreactor here from us. Thank you very much.